Primary biliary cholangitis or primary biliary cirrhosis is an autoimmune disorder that causes inflammation and destruction of intrahepatic bile ducts. This disorder has two major features. It causes inflammation in periportal area and it causes severe cholestasis. Primary biliary cholangitis affects mostly middle-aged women, which is logical because it's an autoimmune pathology, and we know that autoimmune disorders most commonly affect females. As most autoimmune pathologies, primary biliary cholangitis is associated with other autoimmune disorders, as rheumatoid arthritis or Sjögren's syndrome. Basically, the presence of one autoimmune disorder significantly increases the risk of the second autoimmune pathology. And the major diagnostic feature of primary biliary cholangitis is the presence of anti-mitochondrial antibodies. To explain why, we have to know the pathogenesis. So here we have intrahepatic bile duct. Bile ducts provides transportation of bile. And bile has three major components. It's cholesterol, bilirubin, and bile acids. And the most dangerous substance from them all is bile acids, because it's a highly reactive substance that can cause severe damage to biliary cells. To protect themselves, biliary cells have a specific transporter called anion exchanger 2. Anion exchanger 2 provides secretion of bicarbonate. And by secretion of bicarbonate, biliary cells create a protective bicarbonate layer that neutralizes bile acids. So bicarbonate layer protects biliary cells from the bile acids. As most cells in our body, intrahepatic biliary cells have mitochondria. And we have to know that on the surface of the mitochondria located a specific protein called pyruvate dehydrogenase complex E2. The problem is that sometimes anion exchanger 2 do not function properly. It can be caused by mutation from birth, or this dysfunction can develop with life. In these circumstances, biliary epithelial cells cannot provide secretion of bicarbonate. Thereby, they cannot create a protective bicarbonate layer. And without bicarbonate, biliary epithelial cells are left defenseless against bile acids. And with time, constant damage by bile acids provokes apoptosis of biliary epithelial cells. With apoptosis, intrahepatic biliary cells form so-called apoptotic blebs. And inside one of the apoptotic blebs located mitochondria. Then apoptotic blebs undergo phagocytosis by macrophages. And macrophages present some parts of the apoptotic blebs on MHC2 receptors to T helpers. In this case, they present a mitochondrial protein called pyruvate dehydrogenase complex. The logic is that antigen-presenting cells want to know, is mitochondria inside the apoptotic bleb normal material or it's something pathogenic? T helpers scan pyruvate dehydrogenase complex, and in normal condition, T helper recognizes it as a normal substance, and thereby they do not trigger inflammation. But some people have MHC2 receptors that are produced based on HLA-DQ-B1-04 or 08 alleles. And in this case, most probably inflammation will develop. And to explain why, we have to know how antigen presentation occurs. In normal condition, when mitochondria with pyruvate dehydrogenase complex is released, macrophage intakes mitochondria in order to present a small part of the mitochondria in form of pyruvate dehydrogenase complex to T helpers. And antigen presentation occurs by an MHC2 receptor. What we have to know about MHC2 receptor is that it's a protein, and the genetic information that tells us how to make MHC2 receptor is contained in the gene that is located on chromosome 6. And we call this gene HLA-DQB1 gene. But we have different variations of HLA-DQB1 genes, and such variations we call alleles. The simplest analogy is the eye color. You see, we all have genes that encode the color of our eyes, but some of us have blue eyes and some of us have black eyes. And in this case, genes that can cause blue eyes we call blue owl, and genes that can cause black eyes, black owl. So we all have genes that can cause eye color, but each gene can be different. And different variations, which are blue and black colors, of the same gene that in this case can cause eyes, we call alleles. So in case of primary biliary cholangitis, we all have genes that encode MHC2 receptor. We call this gene HLA-DQB1 gene, but this gene can be different. And different variations of HLA-DQB1 gene, we call HLA-DQB1 alleles. For example, if person has HLA-DQB1-01 allele, this person will have MHC2 receptor that was made based on genetic information in HLA-DQB1-01 allele. And such MHC2 receptor presents pyruvate dehydrogenase complex in a perfectly normal way. And when T helpers income to this receptor, they recognize pyruvate dehydrogenase complex as a normal substance. And because of this, they do not see any danger. If person has HLA-DQB1-05 allele, this person will have MHC2 receptor that was made based on genetic information in HLA-DQB1-05 allele. And such MHC2 receptor presents pyruvate dehydrogenase complex also in a perfectly normal way. Thereby, there will be no inflammatory response. But some people have HLA-DQB1-04 allele. Thereby, in this case, person will have MHC2 receptor that was made based on genetic information in HLA-DQB1-04 allele. The problem is that this particular MHC2 receptor do not know how to present pyruvate dehydrogenase complex to T helpers. When T helpers income to MHC2 receptor, in this case, because pyruvate dehydrogenase complex is presented in abnormal way, T helpers cannot recognize it, and thereby they think that it's antigen. Also, some people have HLA-DQB1-08 allele. This MHC2 receptor also do not know how to present pyruvate dehydrogenase complex to T helpers. So when T helper income to scan pyruvate dehydrogenase complex, they cannot recognize it, and thereby they think that it's antigen. In response to any antigen, T helpers immediately becomes activated, and subsequently they induce activation of B lymphocytes which begin to produce antibodies. Also, they activate T killers and macrophages. Altogether, this will cause massive inflammation. So, in individuals that have HLA-DQB1-04 and 08 alleles, MHC2 receptor presents mitochondrial pyruvate dehydrogenase complex in abnormal way. And because of this, T helpers recognize pyruvate dehydrogenase complex as antigen. And in response to antigen, T helpers becomes activated. Once T helper becomes activated, T helper induce activation of B lymphocytes. If B lymphocytes becomes activated, they begin to produce antibodies. And B lymphocytes begin to produce antibodies against pyruvate dehydrogenase complex. And because this complex is located on mitochondria, we call these antibodies anti-mitochondrial antibodies. Antibodies are highly reactive substances that can cause severe direct injury to intrahepatic biliary epithelial cells, and this damage results in their destruction. Also, T helpers activate T killers. And in activated state, T killers massively infiltrate biliary epithelial cells. Their infiltration causes severe damage to biliary cells that also cause their destruction. In addition to this, T helpers activate macrophages. With activation, macrophages begin to proliferate. Their proliferation results in formation of giant cells that form granuloma. And together, activated macrophages can cause severe damage to biliary epithelial cells. So this massive pro-inflammatory cascade results in destruction of biliary epithelial cells. With destruction, they cannot provide flow of bile through the intrahepatic bile ducts. As a result, bile components leak into the blood, its bile acids, bilirubin, and cholesterol. so their level in the blood will progressively increase. Also important that massive inflammation in the liver tissue as a protective reaction induce activation of hepatic stellate cells and portal fibroblasts. With activation, they begin to produce massive amount of collagen, and progressive deposition of collagen molecules with time will cause liver fibrosis, and liver fibrosis with time will cause cirrhosis. To explain clinical symptoms of primary biliary cholangitis, recall that in this disorder, severe autoimmune inflammation causes damage to biliary epithelial cells, and with destruction of biliary cells, bile content leaks into the blood. First of all, its bilirubin, increase in blood bilirubin level, can cause jaundice. The second substance that leaks into the blood is bile acids. Increase in bile acids in the blood can cause pruritus. Also important that because bile ducts are destroyed, now the passage of bile to the biliary tree and hence into the duodenum becomes disrupted. And without bile acids, we cannot absorb lipids. As a result, steatorrhea develops. The third substance that leaks into the blood is cholesterol. Increase in blood cholesterol level causes deposition of cholesterol in the skin. These structures we call xanthoma, and deposition of cholesterol in the eyelids we call xanthelasma. Here we can see xanthelasma and xanthoma in patients with primary biliary cirrhosis or primary biliary cholangitis, it's the same thing. Because now, with severe damage, intrahepatic bile ducts are unable to transport bile further into the biliary tree, bile begin to accumulate. And this condition we call cholestasis. And cholestasis provokes increase in blood alkaline phosphatase and gamma-glutamyl transferase level. Important to remember that in primary biliary cholangitis, the main targets are the small and medium-sized bile ducts. Such bile ducts are located inside the liver. Because of this, inflammation in primary biliary cholangitis causes injury not only to the bile ducts, but also to hepatocytes. And with chronic liver injury, the secretion of thrombopoietin decreases, and thereby thrombocytopenia develops. Also, with liver injury, proteins production by the liver decreases. So albumin level decreases, also the level of coagulation factors decrease, and we can determine this by prolongation of prothrombin time and international normalized ratio. With liver injury, also the level of ALT and AST moderately increase. In primary biliary cholangitis, autoimmune reaction provokes massive production of anti-mitochondrial antibodies. And anti-mitochondrial antibodies belong to immunoglobulin M type. As a result, we can determine increase in blood immunoglobulin M level, which is a characteristic feature of primary biliary cholangitis. As any autoimmune disorder, primary biliary cholangitis is associated with other autoimmune pathologies. So in patients that have, for example, rheumatoid arthritis, Hashimoto thyroiditis or Sjogren syndrome, the risk of primary biliary cholangitis is significantly higher. So the major diagnostic feature of primary biliary cholangitis is the presence of anti-mitochondrial antibodies in the blood. Among biochemical values, we are particularly interested in markers of cholestasis, which are alkaline phosphatase and gamma-glutamyl transferase. Also, we can determine moderate increase in alkaline phosphatase and aspartate aminotransferase level. Destruction of bile ducts causes increase in blood bilirubin level and increase in blood cholesterol level. Both these values we can determine in biochemical analysis. Important that in patients with primary biliary cholangitis, we have to check for osteoporosis or osteomalacia, especially in postmenopausal women. The reason is that with decreasing income of bile acids into the duodenum, the absorption of lipids decreases, including fat-soluble vitamins as vitamin D. This causes decrease in vitamin D level in our organism, and as a result, it causes decrease in calcium absorption. With decrease in calcium absorption, the level of calcium in our organism decreases, and low calcium level provokes osteoporosis. According to current guideline, to make a diagnosis of primary biliary cholangitis, we have to determine changes in biochemical analysis, which is elevation of alkaline phosphatase. Recall that with damage to biliary cells, we are unable to provide bile flow through the intrahepatic bile ducts. As a result, bile stasis develops, and cholestasis induces increase in alkaline phosphatase and gamma-glutamyl transferase, and it's the reason why we consider elevation of alkaline phosphatase as a hallmark of primary biliary cholangitis. The second criteria is the presence of anti-mitochondrial antibodies. Recall that autoimmune reaction results in massive production of anti-mitochondrial antibodies, which cause severe damage to biliary cells. So the presence of anti-mitochondrial antibodies in the blood is a very important feature of primary biliary cholangitis. And the third criteria is histological features. On histology, we have to find destructive cholangitis with destruction of intralobular bile ducts. Recall that damage to biliary epithelial cells lead to a destruction of intrahepatic bile ducts, and also characteristic feature is the presence of granuloma. On these images, we can see different stages of primary biliary cholangitis. Stage 1 is destructive cholangitis, on next stage, damage to bile ducts induced ductal reaction, which is actually activation of regeneration. On third stage, damage to liver tissue provokes fibrosis, and fibrosis here serves as a protective mechanism. By fibrous tissue, liver separates alive tissue from tissue affected by inflammation, and massive fibrosis causes formation of regenerative nodules, which is alive hepatocytes that are surrounded by fibrous tissue. And regenerative nodules are the hallmark of cirrhosis. So primary biliary cholangitis ends up as liver cirrhosis. On this image, we can see bile duct, also we can see granuloma, and in addition to this, we can see massive amount of lymphocytes that infiltrate biliary epithelial cells and liver tissue. Also here we can see damaged bile duct. According to current guidelines, we have two initial options in treatment. If there is no severe cirrhosis, then we can try drugs. And the major medication in treatment of primary biliary cholangitis is ursodeoxycholic acid. If ursodeoxycholic acid do not help, the next step is obeticholic acid. And as a last option, we can try fibrates. But if cirrhosis already developed, the only option left is liver transplantation.